when you are
trouble on Earth again?
No, sir, I'm afraid this time it's trouble in paradise. Right here, with me! I've been channel surfing for hours, and guess what? I've come up dry.
Hours? Indecisive much?
It's that holly jolly time of year again where you can't swing a dead elf without hitting a Christmas film. Hell, I'm 2 seconds from switching on Jingle All the Way and drinking myself into an eggnog coma.
Jingle All the Way? No, Lord. What? We're gonna need a movie expert here and fast. Here, I'll send someone to help us out.
Hey, kids! How you doing?
Oh, not the twisted cartoonist. Hell, where's Gene Shalit?
Sorry to burst your bubblegum crisis, buddy, but I'm afraid Mean Gene's been disposed of. So anyway,
Raf, the situation is quite serious. Blob number two here needs your help with a Christmas movie.
Well, help him, you know, but I'm Blob number two.
Well, no sweat, sweet cheeks. I'll serve you up a Jimmy Stewart film straight out of the oven.
My cheeks, thank you. Blob number two.
Oh, sir, I hate to beg like this again, but if this turns out to be the winner we all think it will be, might I finally win my wings? I've been in the queue for 200 years, and even Leonard Maltin over there got his before me.
Holy mother!
Hello. I'm Leonard Maltin.
See?
How the hell did he pass the bar? Yeah, well, not important. Look, we'll talk about this after the film. Let's all take a look at the film right now.
Okay.
Don't make it weird.
Here goes the Christmas goose.
Okay. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another film discussion. And tonight we're going to be talking about The Shop Around the Corner, a 1940 romantic comedy produced and directed by
Ernst Lubitsch
and starring Margaret Sullavan, James Stewart, and of course, the one and only Wizard of Oz himself, Frank Morgan.
Who rang that bell?
Join us is Patrick Galvan. Hey, Patrick.
I'm not God, I'm just Patrick! Oh no!
False prophet! Stoned!
I'm just a mere mortal who watches movies!
And also join us, outside of Patrick and myself, is Brayton Corner. Say, introduce yourself, Brayton.
I'm Blob number two. I've got you a little cigarette box, Raf. And I know you're a chain smoker. You have a knack for that sort of thing. So this will help you kick that habit.
Awesome. All right, sweet.
Every time you open the box, you have a little song here. So every time you hear that, you will be swayed from smoking.
No, I wanted disco music.
I'd buy that for a dollar.
Mm-hmm. Such great prices they have here at Panachicken.
Don't you know $2.50 is too much for this age of ours? That's like what? It roughly translates to $240?
I actually haven't done the pango conversion to American dollars, so I don't know. That shop could be pricing everything to hell.
So, and speaking of capitalism, let's talk about a film from MGM. Those shameless whores. Well, first off, before I get into my little joke about MGM, Patrick, what's your experience with this movie?
I first saw this film when I was still in college. We were studying early Hollywood movies, and we actually watched another film by Ernst Lubitsch, actually his previous film, Nanochka, with Greta Garbo. I'd never heard of this film or Lubitsch. I just watched this film because it was required of the course material. And this was in like the fall of 2011 or 12, one of the two. And Christmas time that same season, so a couple months later, I find out about this film called Shop Around the Corner from the same director, you know, and written by one of my favorite Hollywood screenwriters, Samson Raphaelson. Like, oh, this sounds like it could be a real winner. and it absolutely was. And yeah, it's just been one of my favorites ever since. And you know, Lubitsch, of course, has become also one of my favorite directors in general since then. But this one, I don't really have a definitive list of Lubitsch films, but this might, for the moment, be my favorite movie of his that I've seen.
Brayton, tell us how you entered Lubitschland. Was it through a rabbit hole, well written and witty?
A doorknob spoke to me and told me, come inside. And
The doorknob, did it have like a very meek but lovable German accent? Oh, everyone always picks on me and calls me an idiot. And I say, yes, Mr. Brayton.
That sounded a little Truman Capote-ish.
Damn it.
How I fell into Ernst Lubitsch's, kind of convoluted, through my discovery of another director, Billy Wilder, who's very well known for, you know, some of the most iconic films of old Hollywood, Sunset Boulevard and Double Indemnity and Some Like It Hot and so on. But the film that really hooked me into him, and to this day, I think it's my favorite movie. I don't think there's anything that really tops it, is The Apartment. That's one film going experience where the wind was knocked out of me by how much it affected me on a personal level. It just hit me at the right time, and the through line of loneliness that film delves into with the Shirley MacLaine character, it really touched me. And so then I was like, oh, I must consume all of his work. And after I had watched the majority of his filmography, I started learning more about his inspirations. And he was very close to Lubitsch, and that he was someone who he considered a mentor, actually had a plaque in his office whenever he would have trouble with a screenplay or coming up with a solution to a problem in a story. He had a sign above his desk that said, how would Lubitsch do it? Kind of like the old, what would Jesus do? So that was kind of my gateway and introduction to him, though, was through someone else. And ever since then, though, I've been a huge fan. And for me, it's a three-way tie between this, To Be or Not to Be, and Trouble in Paradise. Like, I'll fluctuate which one I like more. Very vastly different movies, each of them.
Yeah.
I do want to mention, unlike you guys, I've only really seen three Lubitsch movies. This one, Nanashka, and To Be or Not to Be. Personally, I think To Be or Not to Be might be the better of the three movies, but that's like saying, which bar of gold do you want? Get rid of the other two. I think I saw this movie independently because I saw Frank Morgan. It's like, oh boy, The Wizard of Oz, huzzah! I dropped everything else I was doing at the time, including, you know, a couple of puppies and kitties.
Ka-thunk, ka-thunk, ka-thunk. A pile of animals.
Frank Morgan's on screen, out of here! Anyways, no, I think I watched it independently by myself a while ago, but I actually ended up enjoying the movie quite a bit. And this is like one of those rare Christmas movies I've actually seen more than three times, willingly. Thankfully, you two are bigger experts on this. The plot, has it really been done before, at least in movies? Because I'm thinking there's got to be like some kind of obscure comedy play going on.
No, sure. Well, the source material is a play. I think it's Parfumerie. It's been done, obviously, well, most notably for this film. But the central premise of it has been adapted. I know You've Got Mail is a remake, but I mean, there's that example. There's a movie with Judy Garland and Van Johnson, a musical, which I actually haven't seen, but I did find a copy of it today. So I'll remedy that too. The premise of, you know, opposites attracting, that's become a trope in these movies ever since.
Yeah.
The director Ernst Lubitsch, to me, is probably one of the greatest humanist directors of all time. All of his movies have such a strong human touch to them. And, you know, that's the famous phrase that gets bandied around, is the Lubitsch touch, which is that sort of intangible sophistication that he brings to comedies. He really was one of the giants of the golden age in 1930s cinema. Like, he was very popular and pretty much far and away the most famous director to come from Germany at that time. I mean, now we look at people like even Wilder and Fritz Lang and so on, but he had a real international appeal.
In the course of my research, learning about early Japanese filmmakers, a lot of them idolized Lubitsch. You know, Ozu, Hanasugi Gosho, Yasujirō Shimazu, they all loved this guy. And Hidoshiro, who was the studio boss at Shochaku in Tokyo in the 1920s and forward, and when he was reforming the studios and setting up new programs, he created a screenwriters committee to develop ideas for scripts, and he instructed them to study Lubitsch's film, The Marriage Circle, as a template for a feel-good comedy, because this was after the time of the Great Kanto Earthquake, and he recognized that, you know, the audience wants to feel happy again. You know, basically the directors, the two probably idolized more than anybody else by Japanese filmmakers in this time period were Chaplin and Lubitsch. You know, those were the two general favorites.
He's a filmmaker that influenced so many people and was duly credited in his time, but I feel like as the years have rolled along, much like this movie, his name has sort of unjustly kind of slipped through and gone overlooked. I was really happy to find that the New Yorker actually did a pretty good write-up on him this year. And by New Yorker, I mean the publication, not some guy in New York who was like, hey, I remember when movies was good.
You mess with Lubitsch, you mess with the rest in New York. Yeah.
But still, as time's gone on, I feel like his name's become much less known. And I think that's a real shame because his movies are every bit as sweet, if not sweeter, to watch through today's lens. And we're talking movies that are 80 to 90 years old. It's really a matter of aging like fine wine to me. They haven't lost an ounce of their charm.
You know, it's revisiting this movie, and I've watched it twice this week for this discussion of ours.
Yeah.
It's not just witty, but very contemporary, intelligent in the way it handles relationships in the workplace and how the work environment can be. In fact, you're going to hate me for doing this, but like this movie reminded me a lot of Clerks.
Oh, my God.
In the sense that we've all been in these situations. This is a much older, more classier movie. It takes place in a pre-World War II Budapest. A lot of the situations, especially when dealing with difficult coworkers or trying to get a job or just really, really stupid customers, it's these kind of universal truths to anybody who worked in retail, very much like Clerks in that same way. It's like, yeah, as ridiculous as the situation is, granted, nobody makes look to a dead body here, but
now all I'm going to think is Jay and Silent Bob outside of Matichek.
Yeah. Oh my God, that'd be a great Photoshop picture to do to have Jay and Silent Bob just hanging out with everyone else as they're looking at the window display just before opening. I'm going to do that. Hey, Mr. Music, get out of here, you wacky boys, you. Why does that one never talk?
You must be stopped. So Lubitsch, he's a guy who was really at the ground floor of the advent of movies. He was born in 1892, literally the year after the motion pictures were invented, to a small Jewish family in Germany who I'd hesitate to say they weren't necessarily poor, but they weren't well off by any means. And they actually owned a small mom and pop clothing shop in East Berlin, his father being a tailor. He spent his youth there, and the main driving force behind this movie was sort of doing a tribute to his father's store and the employees who would come in and were very loyal to his family, and he kind of came to know as a bit of extended family members. But he would work under his dad there for quite some time, selling textiles and making ends meet. He was a pretty rambunctious kid and a rambunctious adult for that matter, but as a young teen, he was bitten by the acting bug, as many of us hams are. In his late teens, he got the chance to begin acting in small roles for a man named Max Reinhardt's company, who was one of Germany's most prominent theater directors. And with the advent of this newfangled motion picture machine, he soon transitioned into those. And he would have small parts in these short 15 to 20 minute silent comedies. I think they used to call them two-reelers. So very much to his personality, though, he would often play these small sort of wily practical joker kid type characters, you know, your Weisenheimer shoeshine boys. And I don't know, kind of like the many varied walk on characters that would menace Lou Costello or something like Joe Besser, but more dignified. You understand? That's not too far removed, actually, when you think about it, from Pepe. I guess Pepe was an extension of himself, a self-insert for the shop around the corner.
I kind of see that, especially considering how ultimately overpowered and heroic Pepe becomes in the second half, but we'll talk about that later.
Draw your own conclusions. He would go on acting for a while, and then eventually his first serious work, directing, actually were in silent dramas, sort of in the vein of Cecil B. DeMille historical pictures. He directed a movie about the French Revolution, I think, for instance. Big scale for the time. He really didn't begin dipping his toes into comedy until the early 20s. That's really where he developed his early technique. And he came over here when Louis B. Mayer, who was the head of MGM, went over to Europe just scouting talent to capture into his web of lies, or what'd you call MGM, Raf? The whore palace? What'd you say?
I only bring that up because the shameless whore.
Okay, the shameless whore allure of MGM.
Yeah, I'll get into why I say that in a little bit.
Yeah, but there was this avalanche of other European emigres, you know, actors, directors, technicians, and so on. And Lubitsch was really one of the heads of the table. I mean, he was a really well-known. His work captured the attention of Louis B. Mayer because it had the potential for international appeal. So he'd go on to work for MGM and Paramount at the tail end of the silent era into sound. making three really good movies. The Student Prince in Old Heidelberg is one, The Love Parade and The Smiling Lieutenant, two of which are musicals. And that really put him on the map over here. His last totally straight-laced movie, I think, is called The Broken Lullaby. After that, he really began to master the craft of the comedy, becoming more sharper and more sophisticated. And he carved a real name recognition for himself over here. Not unlike someone like a Chaplin, but he was a star behind the camera, kind of like Hitchcock would become later on, where the movies were promoted with his name. So when people, you know, went to the theaters, they were going to see a Lubitsch picture, a sly and witty premise and innuendo.
Well, it's from my limited experience, it is funny how Lubitsch films do not shy away from the subject of sex, because we have adultery in this movie. We have adultery in To Be or Not to Be.
Yes.
I think things were pretty on the up and up as far as the Nachka goes, but
he likes sneaking around censors, you know, and really flourished as a pre-code director. I think it's in Trouble in Paradise. There's a shot of a shadow of a couple being casted upon a bed. And you gotta imagine some little old biddy in the audience there was saying, "Oh, this is so vulgar," or something.
I like it, but it's vulgar nonetheless. Everyone leave the theater. Leave me be.
One of the reasons time travel would have been so great, plop them in a theater for like body heat or something. it would be like a Raiders of the Lost Ark. Their face would explode.
I think we should also show them Last Tango in Paris.
Oh no!
And Ushma's film In the Realm of the Senses.
Well, hell, if you want to go that far, just show them Sallow or something. Stay low.
Although we could definitely cause a lot of trouble with Showgirls, I know that for sure. And it's not even a good movie, all things considering.
What was I talking about before Showgirls? Innuendo.
Innuendo, yes.
Saying innuendo, I'm not only speaking about the naughty stuff, I'm also speaking more broadly to the idea of setting up situations by suggestion. You know, whether it be jokes or story beats in and of themselves, you know, he'd often operate with like a building block kind of structure, you know, sprinkling details and clues. The humor that comes from them are like grand total of little jokes and little inserts. And there's also a lot of substance to his films, too. They always strike like a perfect balance between irony and sympathy with its characters.
Some actual stakes, too, considering the dark path that some of the characters take in this one.
Yeah, the movies do leave. I mean, in this film alone, right, you have tackles the subjects of adultery and suicide. And like I mentioned at the start, the loneliness between the two characters. He's a really interesting filmmaker. He loved critiquing the bourgeoisie and, you know, sort of poking fun at aristocratic stereotypes. But he was also really fascinated with emotional truths and the inner working of social groups and pushing a lot of boundaries.
Like I said, this film was Clerks before Clerks.
And boy, did Kevin Smith ever push a lot of boundaries until he was pushed off the cliff. The sly innuendo, I think he really could only flourish the way he did in his early days, pre-code. And even then, though, he would sneak around the censors in his later films. So by that point, where this film comes into play, The Shop Around the Corner, he'd actually recently been fired from a very unsuccessful one-year stint at the head of Paramount. I guess he really had a lot of issues delegating responsibilities to people. The position was just not his calling in life. So he went back to directing, and it's a time where he was sort of in a very introspective stage in his life. And the films were still silly, but they did have that more down-to-earth, heavier emotional tone to them. This one is credited to Sam Raffleson, who Patrick mentioned, who was a very prolific writer and was probably his primary collaborator throughout his entire career. And also uncredited, though, is Ben Hecht, who likewise is a very prolific writer and versatile. Like, he wrote on Stagecoach, and then he wrote on this, and then Notorious later on, which are like three ends of the spectrum. And so they hashed out the script. And from the beginning, they actually wanted Jimmy Stewart and Margaret Sullavan as the two leads. But they actually had to hold back production because 39 was a pretty big year for everybody involved. Like, that's one of the historical famous years in old Hollywood is 1939. The Wizard of Oz that year, which, you know, obviously Frank Morgan was in.
Mm-hmm.
But the year prior to this movie, James Stewart was also in Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, which was a huge success. So he was a pretty fresh, hot ticket at the time. So they held back. Time came around where everyone was available, and they assembled a really phenomenal cast. Like, not just the leads, but everybody here primarily also is Felix Bressert, who was one of Lubitsch's stock players. He's also in Ninotchka and To Be or Not to Be. He reminds me kind of like an older Groucho Marx when you see him like on the Dick Cavett show, and he's got a little mustache and golfing hat.
Mm-hmm.
He's a funny looking little fellow, but he's also has great comic timing.
Yeah, and he's just adorable. It's like
I want to pinch his nose.
Yeah, he's like if you ever wanted to imagine what a Pokemon would be like as a little old German man, it'd be this guy.
I don't know what's worse, trading out Jimmy Stewart for Tom Hanks. I can kind of see that, but trading out Felix Besser for Dave Chappelle, what? One interesting thing about it is that it was shot entirely in sequence, which is pretty rare practice, like in general for movies, and rare for Lubitsch himself. But I think maybe under the surface that doing so, just kind of breaking from the fragmented method a lot of productions follow, it does sort of add a seamlessness to the movie and how the characters interact. It's filmed very much like, you know, kind of watching a play, but we follow them along, and really it's that ensemble that is the star of the show. But it's chock full of great performances and sweet moments. And I don't know if it was his favorite movie, but he's quoted as saying that of all the films I made, for me, that had the truest moments in it and the truest characters. So it was a very personal film for Lubitsch.
Lubitsch actually had first bought the rights for the play in July of 1938, 2 years before it was produced. And Samson Raphaelson was working on the script around that time as well. So basically this project was worked on over a course of like 2 or so years, which probably paved the way for the script being as good as it, as wonderful as it is. It was delayed because, as Brayton mentioned, like, you know, Lubitsch was removed from the chief of production position at Paramount. I think it was also the failure of Bluebeard's eighth wife that resulted in him being booted from that position.
Wait, yeah. How does a mythical character's spouse affect a movie production?
Oh, right, movie.
I had to. Yeah.
After he was dismissed from Paramount, he formed Lubitsch Productions and planned to make the movie in October 1938, but then backed out because of quote-unquote loss of nerve. Then Ninotchka came along. And eventually the deal with MGM came around. They paid him $16,500 for the rights. And ultimately, of course, you know, the studio granted him James Stewart and Margaret Sullavan. And going back to Samson Raphaelson, he had written the play The Jazz Singer, which one of Hollywood's first successful partial talkies.
Yeah.
And Lubitsch had actually persuaded Warner Brothers to purchase the rights for that play. So even though he didn't direct the film himself, he was still kind of integral in getting Samson Raphaelson's, you know, film career really going off with that being purchased and whatnot. Raphaelson said that he really liked working with Lubitsch because he said that Lubitsch respected the art of writing. And he said something to the effect of, like, you know, when you work with Lubitsch, you don't write for him. You kind of write with him. Even though he's not writing the script himself, you know, he's still there with you, you know, piecing together the story and whatnot.
Yeah.
You know, kind of like Hitchcock in that sense. And by the way, Raphaelson did write Hitchcock's Suspicion.
Right.
Fun little factor there. But you know, just kind of with Hitchcock. You know, Hitchcock already has his story in mind, and the writer works with him to kind
fleshing
of
it out.
Flesh it out and whatnot. So, and, you know, shot in sequence over a period of, I think it was 27 days. Took 2 years for the thing to come along, but the end result was more than worth it.
Yeah, and I think it does get a little... The criticism I see, really the only popular criticism of the movie, is that, well, everybody's speaking English. No one pays much mind to Jack Benny not speaking Polish or whatever it is in Warsaw. No one has a problem with that, but no one can buy...
Yeah, I was going to ask you that, though. The characters in this movie are all meant to be Hungarian, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Nobody has a Hungarian accent.
Yeah, but it doesn't break the reality of the movie for me, or the setting, because they're not speaking a language. I mean, and that's very popular in a lot of old movies. They do not speak the language of wherever they're taking place, and I'm fine with it. It doesn't bother me that
much. Oh yeah, like what is it, the very first version of All Quiet on the Western Front, it's like these characters are supposed to be German, but you know, those are clearly American accents coming through.
It helps when it's not another ethnicity, though. Then it helps.
Yes.
You don't want 50 Mickey Rooneys running around a place. one's more than enough.
Yeah, imitating accents wasn't really a thing until Meryl Streep came along, so there you go.
Though in Ninotchka, Bela Lugosi does have a very small part. And I'm just imagining Bela Lugosi in this movie, maybe in the Matacek role or something. That'd be a different one. Where he started doing the Ed Wood cuss outs to everybody.
Throw me that whiskey.
I think you would be better left out of this store. Buzz off!
There's a lot of great attention to detail, though, in the shop itself, because that's sort of our home base as a setting. I read that weeks were spent like obtaining inventories from different shops actually in Budapest and like making notes of the items they would carry and that they would place in their storefront.
I wanted to mention, yeah, this movie's production design is extremely good. It's like not only is the shop well realized, but I wanted to give props to the main Budapest street set. Yeah, it's obviously filmed inside a studio, but I do appreciate a lot of the detail they gave outside of the store, and even some of the sequences where when there is a panning out shot, they combined it with like a matte painting to show off the sky. But what I thought, the element I thought really, really sold the idea that this is its own little Budapest street world, so to speak, this set, was the overuse of fog and mist throughout the whole movie. A morning mist, so to speak, here on a Budapest street. But yeah, no, I really, really appreciated the production design, all this. And what you just said really makes sense of this being a more collaborative effort than most other Hollywood movies of the age. But then again, that may have been the attitude at MGM, because MGM really knew how to make movies.
I don't know a whole lot about in terms of what they changed from the play to the movie, but one that was absolutely brilliant was that in the play, the Margaret Sullavan character, Miss Novak, is already an employee at the store at the very beginning of the story. In the movie, they did the great idea of having her apply and kind of have to comically prove herself worthy of the job, start this drama and introduce her to the narrative. And that was absolutely brilliant on both Lubitsch and Ravelson's part.
Yeah. Yeah. It really sets up her character very well. And yeah, her quick thinking of changing, oh, it's a candy box. her performance is tremendous throughout the film, but yeah, that scene specifically. And it spins off that back and forth relationship between her and Jimmy Stewart.
And it's funny too, because even when they're at their meanest against each other, especially after Jimmy Stewart's character realizes who she really is, but she doesn't know, so she's still very biting and all this. It's like, you know, please leave. I could never find myself falling for somebody like you, you dick.
Dingus.
You dork. But no, you actually do buy that chemistry, even if it's just an acting chemistry of them, you know, playing off each other in both the good and the bad moments of comedy.
Well, I think the fact that Lubitsch studied acting definitely is a factor into the bullseye tone he always gets out of his actors in his movies.
Yeah, I could definitely see that. And again, it's nice to revisit these old movies because you really do see the influence of the theater creeping into these films, where today everything is so, like, the theater doesn't even matter anymore, doesn't it? It's almost kind of a lost art that's been so separated from filmmaking.
Well, the theater used to be what was revered, you know, and the cinema was the joke. But now you've got so many, you know, sitcoms or just TV shows, whatever, where whenever they cut to a theater performance, it's your local community theater. And, you know, there's an 80-year-old fat guy who wants to play Lancelot or something. And it's treated, it's really sillily. And of course, you know, he didn't shy away from doing that with thing, you know, going back to his roots with like To Be or Not to Be has a theater company of knuckleheads, but they're very charming and it's not mean-spirited in that way either. Which also another great ensemble, but the respect for the theater I think has definitely become less and less in recent decades.
Yeah, it's like, what is it like back, like you just said, the theater was much more revered back then. Today the theater is kind of treated as, oh, it's that leopard colony we sent all the unpopular actors to. I don't care if they get something artistically satisfying out of it. We the regular public and media doesn't give a shit about the theater. Spit. Yeah,
big actors do still, you know, have some reverence for it. But when you see things like that, it's kind of like, you know, are all these ad spots I'm seeing just capitalizing on popular television star, popular movie star? Like no one really makes an event of things being on Broadway or...
Yeah. It's like, what is it? Like the theater scene in Los Angeles is practically dying. It's like they're used, like, or in the early 2000s, there was like tons of independent theaters and tons of local, not just local, but like, you know, beginning classes that would do theaters that you could pay and enter. Now there's barely any of those left.
Kind of spinning off what you guys are talking about. Like, I remember about 10 or 12 years ago, Al Pacino starred in a big lavish Broadway version of Merchant of Venice, which probably partially because of his star power got an extended run on Broadway and was later adapted with him in it into a, I think it was a television miniseries or a television movie So yeah, those things happen now and then, but I think nowadays Broadway is basically like, you know, it's something that it's mainly for tourists visiting New York more than anything else. That's what it seems to have come down to. I'm sure the pandemic has not helped at all. I mean, that, you know, that movie theaters are struggling because people just stay at home and watch Netflix and whatnot. It's compounding what was already a problem to begin with having so much entertainment available at home. And the shitstorm we've dealt with the last couple of years has only taken that problem and just made it much, much worse.
The balloon was deflating. Now it's popped.
Exactly. Yeah. And the theaters had probably suffered more than cinema has.
I do want to talk about Hugo Mushnik. How do you say his last name again? Mushnik? Mushnik?
Matacek is what you're trying to say?
Thank you. Matacek.
Hugo Mushy Face.
Okay, Matacek.
They say it like 50 billion times.
I know, but the silent S got me, okay?
Frank Morgan throws around Matacek more than like Quentin Tarantino throws around racial obscenities. I mean, every second.
No, Mr. Matacek. I think he's probably my favorite character out of the whole movie. I'll be absolutely honest. And yeah, a big part of that is the bias towards Frank Morgan, because one of my all-time favorite movies is The Wizard of Oz. And he's one of the secret magic of The Wizard of Oz, in the sense that he's practically playing all the other characters that the lead stars aren't playing. But no, what's great about Mr. Matacek here is that not only is he my favorite character, but I think he might be the strongest character of them all, in the sense that he has a really great story arc. It's very much like before we were recording, ladies and gentlemen, we were discussing our favorite Christmas Carol adaptations. And this does have a bit of a Scrooge type feel to it, where Mr. Matacek is a little standoffish, a little, I don't want to call him a mean boss. He seems relatively fair, but when things start to get
just high strung, would be
high
a term.
Strung. Thank you. Yeah. When things start to get a little stressful for him, however, he does bark, you know, barks like a dog towards the employees. He takes oh my God, poor Perovich.
I used to call you an idiot.
Yeah, the punching bag of this movie. And he has a great character arc too, but no, he starts off as sort of a Scrooge type figure. Granted, nowhere near as bad as Scrooge, but like you said, very high strung, very stressed out. And it's cool how it's slowly revealed why he's stressed out, why he's all of a sudden, because the movie starts with the mentioning of an unseen dinner he took Jimmy Stewart's character to.
Yeah, and he's very passive aggressive with, your wife liked what you wrote. Yes.
Yeah, exactly.
Or my wife liked it. Yeah, because he thinks that Jimmy Stewart's character is having the affair with his wife.
Which makes no sense whatsoever, because considering how much he bats heads with Margaret Sullavan's Miss Novak, why the hell would he fall in love with the horrific unseen horror that is Mrs. M.
The Aunt MacGuffin, the wife MacGuffin.
Yes, a character we never see, but by all the details we're given is a pretty miserable, spoiled lady. So he has a near-death experience because halfway in the movie he discovers the truth about who's really sleeping as his wife. Yeah. Who's really stooping his strudel, if you will. Stooping her strudel. Wow.
How vulgar.
How vulgar, sir.
We're in Hungary. I had to.
How vulgar. This is worse than the time I saw that young woman suck. Ooh, how vulgar.
Yeah, and then, of course, he tries to commit suicide, although he does use a gun, right? Is that what that loud noise is?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yep, and then, which I think that scene is done really well.
Yes.
It is wonderfully played how it just subtly is hinted that him being passive-aggressive, him being a little weird towards Jimmy Stewart's character, and then, of course, yeah, it's revealed when he sends everyone. First off, he fires him, which is like, that's a little bit of an extreme mood to somebody you're just grumpy with. Yeah. And then he gets even more defensive/threatening. That's another thing about Mr. Matacek. As lovable as he can be and as sympathetic as you can, Frank Morgan really gives a lot of menace to the character, too, especially that scene where Porovich is trying to kind of defend Jimmy Stewart's poor character, only if it's like, do you want to keep your job? Well, you better get out of here. Yeah. And I think we've all been in situations like that, especially with a boss who isn't exactly willing to be honest for better or ill, if you will.
I think that scene where Alfred, Jimmy Stewart's character, is saying his goodbyes to everybody after he has been fired, it kind of does hit you on an emotional scale, because it's almost, they're more than like a, it's almost a family dynamic, like being shunned by your father or something.
Like they mention outright, Alfred's been there since he was a little kid, and Matacek was like a secondary father to him.
Yeah, the whole group feels his, you know, loss. It's not people whispering, oh, did you hear Tammy got fired? No, they've formed such such a bond as a small little group. The character dynamics are just so great in this film.
Yeah, it's like after Mr. Majik has his like near-death experience file suicide, he's almost born again, basically, when he's at the hospital and he has the reconnection with Alfred, Jimmy Stewart's character. And it's like, oh, my boy, I can't believe I blamed you for all this. And of course, Jimmy Stewart gets a triumphant return when he's now the manager of the store while Mr. Mojcik is healing. And of course, it all ends in that really kind of ultimately sweet sequence where everyone's going off to their various families and lovers for Christmas. Mr. Malachek is seen if anybody's free. And it's so cute how he's like, you know, he doesn't say it outright, but he's being very quiet about it. It's like, oh, what, do you have any plans for the night?
Or yeah,
like,
it is.
And then Rudy, wonderful little Rudy, the new whipping boy, the delivery boy, I should say.
Yeah, Pepe's new minion.
Yeah, exactly. He comes in, it's like, oh, it's like, thank you so much for the gift, Mr. Malachek. It's like, I got nowhere to go. You got nowhere to go? Oh, my boy.
How would you like to have a big turkey?
Yes, yes, Mr. Malachek.
Some red lettuce on the side. Oh, my God. And then to top it all off, whipped cream with applesauce.
There are two beautiful endings to the movie. Obviously, the one where the identities are revealed, mm-hmm. but like that one specifically too.
Oh yeah,
is just a sweet capper, and yet him basically telling them all that they're his family when he gives out the bonuses after the big, you know, the big sale day.
Yeah, and he can afford it too now that Mrs. M is out of there. That
wish. I know. M is for monster. Yeah.
But yeah, no, I think Mr. Malachek is my favorite character out of the whole thing. Although, I do have to ask, like, I don't think I've seen that many movies with Frank Morgan in it. Has he ever played a bad guy? Because it's almost hard to, like, I think this is probably the closest I've seen him in a antagonistic role. And even though he's good in it, I can't imagine him being, like, a terrifying villain like a Mr. Potter in another movie or something of that nature.
Yeah, he's done serious roles, but off mm-hmm. the top of my head, nothing really comes to mind as a pure antagonist.
Yeah.
Okay. I think he's just, you know, he's too lovable. He is. That's just his personality. You know, that's his, he's got there's a warmth to him, even in his shoutiest moments.
Oh yeah. It's like, we're more heartbroken and a little upset at Mr. Malachek's anger, especially it being, I have a big old note here. Poor Perovich, played by Felix Bessart. It's like the poor abuse he gives that otherwise decent little old man. He just attracts like, unwanted wrath from Mr. Malachek for no reason whatsoever. So, but I do love that they do kind of reconcile in the second half of the movie, especially towards the end. It's like, I've called you an idiot many times and I want to make up for it. I think you will see in this little bonus of mine. So, but yeah, no, I think Frank Morgan is really good in this one. Do we talk about the Judas of this movie?
The Judas.
The traitor, the two-faced lizard.
Yeah, there's no, I wouldn't say that there's really a absolute defined antagonist of the film, mm-hmm. but he's definitely the
sourest link in the chain, yes.
Yes, the source of a lot of this infighting.
Yeah.
Mr. Lubitsch.
Sadly, you guys are going to have to say the name of the character and the actor, because I'm looking at it on Wikipedia and Joseph Sikorot, who plays
Joseph Francis, Sauerkraut.
Yeah, Sauerkraut. who plays Francis Vidas?
Lubitsch. His real name is Joseph. I think it's Schildkraut. Just say Schildkraut.
Schildkraut. Okay. Now that's fun to say now that I know how to say it. Schildkraut. Joseph Schildkraut presents
Schildkraut scooped his strudel. Is that what you're going to say next?
Schildkraut sold strudels down by the seashore at Modercheck and Company.
Thank you very much for putting me in your poems.
But, I would write it differently, of course.
Yeah, but Lubitsch. Yeah, Lubitsch is a unique character because he is a realistic weasel / passive-aggressive bully. And it's funny, too, because
you can tell everybody doesn't like him, though, from the start. Oh. Like, even Perovich, when he goes to talk to Perovich, he's like, I don't know, leave me alone, why am I talking to you?
Well, that's because, like you mentioned, you can tell these people have had a history with each other, and even knowing Lubitsch turns out to be the snake in the Garden of Eden, it's hilarious how everyone's very defensive and suspicious around him. And I hate to say it, it's like we've all known people like Lubitsch, that kind of weasel mm-hmm. who kind of throws people under the bus whether they mean to or not. Mm-hmm. And if you've never known somebody like that from an old job, you probably were that person. So but yeah, no, he plays the character really well. And what's most interesting about Lubitsch, though, is, again, he's not a true villain. He is two-faced, but it's not like how these kind of characters are usually portrayed, where they're all sweet and like, sure, he's a complete kiss-up when Mr. Modicek is around. So, can I help you, Mr. Modicek? Well, yes, Mr. Modicek. Oh, Mr. Modicek, I think it's a fantastic idea buying these horrible little boxes. but yeah, it's not like a Dr. Jekyll or Mr. Hyde type effect, where you know what he's doing is wrong, and it's like the minute Mr. Modicek is gone, it's like suddenly, now I'll show my true evil self. Am I well dressed? But no, it's like,
but still, you don't feel an ounce of sympathy for him when he gets kicked out on his ass.
No, because yeah, he's a bit unlikable when you first meet him, but you don't really think too much of his character other than that, oh yeah, this is the weasel of the job. Yeah. But when you find out what he's doing and the way he acts about it, I get the feeling that this is a really good portrayal of somebody who's sociopathic without being like overly dark or terrible about it. Like he really, like, you know, he doesn't want to be caught, obviously, but like a lot of sociopathic people, he doesn't feel too bad about it, nor does he really think about any of the harm that's happening. It's all fun and games until you get stuck in a corner. So, and with that says, like, even knowing that, yeah, It's a Wonderful Life is probably the more famous and popular movie, this one has one of the best villain comeuppance ever in cinema, as far as these old romantic comedies go, because I just love how nobody outright confronts him or tells him about why he's being fired or why he's being kicked out or why everyone is suddenly cold, but everyone but he knows. And I just love that last day on the job where Vadish is being like, Vadish, you know, all those brown suitcases on the top and all those black suitcases on the bottom. I want you to put those black ones on top and those brown ones on the bottom and then come see me. And of course, the great sequence where they just, you know, basically kick his ass.
I do love what Frank Morgan tells Kralik in the hospital is he wants him dismissed quietly. Well, that didn't happen. But here's a list of things that didn't happen. That,
you know, he's the slimy villain done right. He's not over the top. He's not underplayed. There's not like some kind of like big crazy twist and like he's like not like trying to like, you know, take over the store or shut it down or whatever. Like you'd seen him probably like in a leopard film, for example. But no, they play right and they send him out with a nice big crash, which is quite satisfying.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And is it kind of rare to see James Stewart go on the rampage like that? It's like he's way taller than almost everyone else in this movie, but it's like, oh, you want a letter of recommendation, huh? Well, I'll give you one with my fists.
Well, he does have, you know, even in It's a Wonderful Life, he does flip a switch. He can be a shouty man.
Yeah, so much so that he ends up becoming the Frankenstein monster of that alternate universe.
Remember the ending of Vertigo where he drags Kim Novak up the stairs, you know, shouting at her
He's the reason I can't really get into Vertigo is because he's so unpleasant in that movie. He's as lovable as we, you know, have this fond image of him being the most, you know, probably the most warm all-American actor of all time, still at the end of the day a great actor and can do both sides of that.
Yeah, but no, it's like I think this is the only time in cinema history I was actually terrified for somebody's life because Jimmy Stewart was throwing him across the room like a rag doll.
Yeah, it's that hidden skinny strength, Raf. We all possess it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was actually Stewart reenacting his fight with Henry Fonda. That's how he
that's how it went. Henry Fonda didn't get a lick in.
Yeah, I don't remember if Sullivan and Fonda were married at this time, but I can only imagine like, oh, James, that was a great performance. What did you use for your method acting? Oh, I remember throwing your husband across the floor.
May we head off to what might be the most powerful character in the whole movie?
The OP Ernst Lubitsch proxy Pepe. Yes.
The Adventures of Battle Errand Boy.
And my little bicycle.
Yes, Pepe Katana. Katana?
You say Pepe Katana, he sounds like a samurai or something.
I know! His name is almost Katano. Kotana. Okay, Pepe. We'll just call him
Let's call the whole thing off.
Yeah. Yes. Pepe, played by William Tracy. Yeah, he's really does come into his own, like some really funny comical banter in the first act, but he really comes to his own in the second act. And I think it's great when we have that sequence where he's doing all these different errands for Mrs. M. And then Mrs. M, being the horrible unseen monstrosity that she is, calls up to yell, you know, to basically report on the Pepe's less than stellar service. Which, you know, we've all been there. It's like, if you don't do something right, they're going to, you know, throw the book at you. Pepe ends up being like the secret hero of the whole movie when he's actually there to save Mr. Modicek from his suicide attempt. Although, of course, it's all done off camera. So how do you think he came in and saved the day? Did he just leap across the room and grab the gun? Did he use his mind powers?
Well, he probably unsheathed his katana, Raf, and pulled the Zatoichi and just sliced a dozen heads
off. Looking at the character's last name. It's almost spelled katana, you jerk.
That's that's brilliant. That's brilliant of Lubitsch to, like, you know, have that, just those scenes of him just walking around. Isn't it filmed almost exclusively with one take, with him just walking around the, and the camera's always moving about back and forth, so it's not stage-like whatsoever. The audience can fill in the blanks by themselves and have their own imagination. Oh. I miss that in movies.
To what, like I was saying about innuendo, you know, letting, and as Pepe would said, draw your own conclusions. It makes you feel more involved when you don't see things like that, and you didn't see him unsheath the katana and do a ninja flip and deflect the bullet.
I like to think he turned into a werewolf for a brief moment and saved Mr. Matichek by biting the bullet literally and figuratively. Pepe is a great character, and like you said, he probably was a self-insert character. That's why he gets all, like, some really hilarious lines, especially when Pepe less than subtly nudges Frank Morgan's character into giving him a raise slash position rise, if you will.
Pepe had a little power trip.
Yes, exactly. And of course, it's confusion and fear from the other characters, too. It's like, who made you a clerk?
When in his introduction, I thought Pepe would be the weak link for me. Power trip aside, and his treatment of Rudy, whatever that will become aside, I find him very likable.
I don't know much about the actor, but William Tracy, it's like he seems like one of those actors who only really made movies between 1938 and 1959. So he kind of had a short career then. But he's really good in this role. He's like, imagine Mickey Rooney, but likable and good.
I can't.
Maybe the Andy Hardy series would have taken off if they just recast William Tracy instead of Mickey Rooney
for awful,
garbage, pointless last Andy Hardy film.
Patrick, do you have something to say about that terrible Mickey Rooney person?
I hate that movie so. And here's the thing: I love the Andy Hardy movies. I love them. Like, even the lesser ones are really funny and very charming slice of life kind of movies.
Mm-hmm.
But that last one was just so pointless. And Rooney wasn't playing Andy Hardy; he was playing Mickey Rooney at that point. And that's just
an unpleasant portrayal.
I don't like that movie, to put it gently.
You've Got Mail is, you know, this on the surface level, but something that could potentially age this movie well, like in a positive sense, meaning that it's aged well, is the correspondence with Love from Abroad. Or that you think is abroad in this case.
Yeah, no, that's a good point because this movie is something of a period piece because it was made in the 1940s, but takes place like maybe a decade or two before the war. But it's so sad now thinking about it, we're so far in the distant future where everyone has a Twitter robot lodged in their skull, that both movies are now unfortunately out of date for both reasons that are understandable and not understandable. Because, I can kind of buy the original movie being a timeless piece, but there's people today who have no idea you can actually communicate with people through regular mail back then or even now. And of course, You Got Mail deals with early internet. Granted, we still deal with internet conversations and all that, but not to the extensive points where emails are considered just as valuable as regular letters.
One of the things that I find most appealing about You've Got Mail is that it kind of, I think this applies to you and me, Raf, most of all, but it reminds me of the days when internet had to, like, you know, dial up and shit like that.
Oh,
and,
God.
You know, you could make a phone call and it was like,
You Got Mail. Goodbye.
Well, this is also the days where you had, like, you know, Windows 95, and the computer would say, it's now safe to turn off your computer. It would actually tell you that on the screen before you turned your computer off. It was safe to do it at this point.
Yeah.
And then you have to ask yourself, was I in danger? I've never had a pen pal in a love situation. I had one pen pal once as a school assignment. That's it, where we communicated by handwritten letters because we had to. And I never kept in touch with the guy. This was like, I don't know, fifth grade or something. Right. And I vaguely remember I used to build soapbox derby cars or something. But
Mother Russia.
In Budapest. I think there's something to be said, though, for long distance relationships, not romantically, but us, for example, communicating through social media and what have you. And I know obviously this goes against it being they're under each other's nose the whole time, but just the concept of it, forming relationships with people and really connecting with people. I think this movie, you know, maybe we're not as witty and our letters to each other aren't as witty. We usually send gifts and memes of David.
Hey, idiot. We're going to do the podcast.
But what I'm saying is we've sort of, in our own way, we've become good friends through this bizarre form at first of never really knowing each other in person at all. And then it becoming an event when we finally do get to meet.
Yeah. You know, it's funny, since Patrick and I are from the 90s and whatnot, believe it or not, we're not as ancient as you think we are, Burton.
You're from the 1890s, Pat.
the 1290s. Okay. I got to constantly remind
you. You're from 90.
I miss my pen pal, Joey, the Mammoth Kings. Anyways,
whatever happened to Ben-Hur?
The funny thing is, though, yeah, growing up during that time, yeah, I recognize that era where the internet was a new thing and you were doing all these amazing things where you could actually talk to people online. But oddly enough, I also remember like how it was like to find out that, oh, some of these people who I'm talking on Rodan Roost or one of these kaiju forums is somebody who actually lives in relative near distance to me. Like, believe it or not, Mark, we actually met through online, through Rodan Roost. And then one day, I don't know if it was him or I, but I revealed, oh, I'm doing a kaiju marathon at a local local comic book shop. And it's like, oh, dude, you live in the same city I do. It's like, yeah, you want to come on down? Okay. And of course, when Mark showed up, he was like dressed in like a leather jacket and sunglasses. It's like, oh, shit, this guy's too cool for me. And of course, oddly enough, before Wynn moved to Tennessee, I knew her online, thanks to Andres recommending her as a voice actress. I remember how it was like back in the old days of the internet and finding out, oh, I could actually meet some of these people in person. It's like, that's kind of a pleasant surprise. Like, yeah, us getting together at G-Fest is one thing because, you know, but that's like a very expensive, you know, ordeal, so to speak, at worst. A minor miracle at best. But yeah, to find out that there's actual people nearby, it's like, now granted, You Got Mail kind of does it ridiculously where they're basically living next door to each other, or it seems that it feels that way, like they're only just a few blocks from one another. And it's New York. That city is, from what I understand, horrifically huge.
Do you want to finally sort of hint at the remake? Since we're covering a lot of ground here.
We're getting towards the end here, so yeah, we're going to have to touch on the remake. Not exactly a horror. We've been kind of building up this movie being so terrible, but it really is. It's kind of a disappointment in a sense compared to this movie.
You've got meh. It's meh. It's just you know, whatever.
I've confessed before, maybe it's the drugs talking. I still like Sleepless in Seattle very much. That's same team up of Meg Ryan and Tom Hanks, and they do have, for what it's worth, they do have a chemistry.
It's the same director, Nora Ephron.
Yeah, Nora Ephron, right. I just think that the whole movie is, and I want to make the distinction, I love romantic comedies, I hate rom-coms. And rom-coms meaning, you know, compare the You Got Mail with this movie, even in the little things like the sound score. There's hardly any music at all in The Shop Around the Corner, which, you know, there's the dialogue is the music, so you don't need it. That would take away from things.
Right.
But in You've Got Mail, you've got that obnoxious rom-com wonka wonka dink-a-donk shoodle-doo boing 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 hijinks music. and that and the pop song to act as a scene transition, where, you know, good songs, but literally every time they cut to another scene, just an obnoxious music drop in there on someone's Spotify playlist, or I guess at the time their iTunes playlist, what have you.
Or Pirate Bay.
Or LimeWire. Yeah, something like that.
So cut to Patrick. Well, I think Uptown Girl. Why is that some music playing?
it's an obnoxiousness that turns me off to the movie.
Okay, here's the thing. I've seen enough contemporary romantic comedies from like the mid-2000s to today that I think are way more obnoxious and even relatively unforgivable compared to You Got Mail, because I'll be honest with you, I was dreading to watch You Got Mail, but I felt I owed it because we're doing a conversation about Shop Around the Corner, and we should mention this, You Got Mail is a loose remake of this movie.
Yes.
It's not a direct adaptation, but it's the same gist.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, first strike against You Got Mail. No attempted suicide. So it's like instantly...
Except from the audience.
Yeah, yeah. So instantly the movie loses 80 stars as far as I'm concerned. Yeah,
anyway.
Yeah. But anyways, no, I did go into You Got Mail with a lot of dread because it's like romantic comedies can be horrific. Rom-coms. Yeah, romantic comedy is one thing. A rom-com
yeah, is something
they,
else.
They're usually very obnoxious and even very offensive, especially if you're world-weary like I am. But it's funny.
His own world, Patrick.
I watch the news. I know everything's going down the pooper. Anyways. Yeah. Did you guys see the movie before we began our research?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, then. Yeah. Because the way you guys talk about this movie, it was like, oh, my God, this is going to be horrible. But I'll be honest with you. There are a couple of elements that work really well, and I'll get to those in a moment. And the movie wasn't as obnoxious as I thought it was. Like, the biggest surprise was Craig Kinnear's character. I thought he was going to turn out to be a complete and total scumbag in the end. But no, it's just, he's just an incompatible friend who is better as a friend than a boyfriend. And I do have to admit, I will give this movie credit for having a scene where the breakup is more of just a friendly get-together. It's like, you know, this isn't working out, but we can still be awesome, you know, and share our different thoughts and all that. And yeah, it's funny, too, because Greg Kinnear and Parker Posey, who are both in this movie, and they're both playing the significant others of Tom Hanks' character and Meg Ryan's character. And that's another thing about 90s films that kind of get under my skin a lot. You know how they say a writer writes what they know, and sometimes you can see their terrible biases come through the screenplays. There was a lot of people in the 90s who were not happy with their other relationships. So there were always, every story, regardless if it was an action movie or horror movie, the significant other they don't like ends up getting killed or divorced or runned over or accidentally shot out of a cannon. And yet this is one of the few movies that kind of handles the breakup with Parker Posey and Greg Kinnear's characters with some maturity and some actual honest to goodness heart and humor.
Any movie that has Jean Stapleton at least gets my attention. And her character Birdie, who isn't she, wasn't she in love with Franco or something? Wasn't that a philosophy?
Yeah, it seems that way. Although they set up a lot of things, but they never pay off.
Yeah.
I will say this, though. So Shop Around the Corner is a much better movie, especially since it has a suicide attempt. So it gets all the stars.
Maybe that's my thing with This in the Apartment, is Christmas suicides are just my bag. I don't know.
It's a Wonderful Life has a suicide attempt.
That too? Oh, my God.
Yeah. So
it's all coming together now.
Yeah, there's no suicide attempts in A Christmas Carol, but we got dead people in the future. So thank you, Ghost of Christmas Future. You Got Mail does something very clever in its own right. And that's, we actually get to read and hear what the emails themselves are. And we get to know the relationship they're building online. So it contrasts a lot better than the relationship we see when they actually interact with each other. And that's why the sequence where Tom Hank, you know, kind of foolishly and almost childishly, after he finds out that Meg Ryan is his secret crush, he tries to talk to her at the coffee place. And of course, he's, you know, he's in disbelief and he's not acting very well. He's being just a child who's pulling ponytails, so to speak. But yeah, that scene.
Yeah, doing the 152. I would like to label my review for the movie, Mr. 152 Minutes I'll Never Get Back.
And yeah, I know you guys think it's funny, but I'm not being anti-intellectual. But yeah, there's a lot of people who'd be watching Shop Around the Corner today and not understand the attraction through the letters. It's like, oh, yeah, they're just Shakespeare fans? Pff, F it.
Well, listen, I'll give the voiceover narration props for lending me for all eternity a voice clip of Tom Hanks saying, "Hello, it's Mr. Nasty," because I'm going to be using that as my ringtone from now on. Uh-huh. But so I'll agree with you slightly for that reason alone, a very selfish reason.
Yeah, but no, with that said, though, I think the biggest problem, the movie's heart is in the right place. But its head is far removed from the shoulders.
Well, no, thanks to the ending. Yes. And it having, I don't buy for a minute at all. And Patrick mentioned this a little bit, and then you hushed us so we could save it for the podcast. They could have had something if they didn't get together. But because they did the stupid rom-com thing of they have to get together, and Tom Hanks shows up in the parts and Over the Rainbow plays, and it's just so maudlin and ear gouging, eye gouging. I mean, the guy ruined her life. It ruined their business. Yeah. And he plays a legitimate asshat in the film. I don't buy it for a second.
Yeah, that's the thing. They modernized the story by having the literal shop around the corner is the name of the store that Meg Ryan, you know, owns and works in, little bookstore. And Tom Hanks is a executive in a big book chain store that's going to force her out of business. And he knows this, and he purposely, you know, wipes her out. But yeah, there's that connection between them through their emails, and he's trying to like win her over at the end. And then there's this idiotic scene towards the end where they're walking along. There's a point where he says, how can you forgive somebody for standing you up, but not forgive me for a tiny little thing of wiping out your business? And I'm like, did you seriously just compare those two things? They're not equivalent. somebody standing you up is not going to ruin your livelihood and force you to rethink your life and whatnot. Are you really comparing that to wiping out the store that her mother owned before her? So it's like an inheritance, it has a personal attachment to her. And you're comparing those two things. It's idiotic. And then yes, the ending, like, you know, they could have had like this really challenging ending. Like, okay, well, we have this bad stuff in the past that binds us. Let's just see what happens at this point on moving forward. And then let the audience, like, you know, think it out for yourselves. But yeah, you can't have a challenging ending. You get fewer and fewer of them as time goes on. This is the point where they're really starting to go away.
Yeah. Now, around the same time, I think it's the same year or maybe a year before, there's that James L. Brooks movie, As Good As It Gets, where at the end, Helen Hunt and Jack Nicholson's character get together. And Jack Nicholson is, you know, sort of the joke and his character arc is that he's an absolute dick at the start of the movie. But it also has one of the just most unbelievable they have to get together endings at the end of the film. Maybe it was just a thing in the late 90s or whatever, where they had to have that. They had to have the obnoxious opposites attract, where sure, it can date back to things like Shop Around the Corner, but without reason and just to have that ending, like no logical purpose behind it.
It's like a lot of 1950s cinema where it's like, oh, everybody's got a hookup at the end regardless. That's what the Hays Code says. I mean, that's what audiences expect.
Everybody has to hook up, but we can't see it.
Yeah, exactly.
because that's too vulgar.
Yeah, and you do get a feeling with a lot of 90s movies where romantic subplots are just thrown into your face for no reason whatsoever. Like as bad as rom-coms can get, family films and children films of the 90s are even way worse. Why can't these characters of opposite sexes just be friends and go on this adventure? Do they have to have a kissing sequence? Do they have to, you know, think about what a relationship would be at when they're freaking 11 or 10 years old, for crying out loud? I will give credit to You Got Mail. They try to smooth the edges a bit in the third act of the movie, where they do try to become friends, and she loses her shop, but at least she kind of gets a new high-paying job as an author with Parker Posey's character as a publisher. What you guys do bring up, you bring up a really good point, because unfortunately, and I try not to think, I say context is everything, and if you know about the background behind a film or a story and have a better idea what the historical or cultural situation is, you can kind of understand the decisions, even if the decisions are terrible ones. But unfortunately, You Got Mail suffers from a lot of movies that from the late 90s suffer from. And it's that sort of end of history naivety where we think, oh yeah, corporations are good and there's nothing really bad with the economic situation and everything's going well. And oh yeah, you lost your little independent shop that's been in your family forever, but that's okay because now you're with the big boys and all that. And that they may have been something that was unintentional on the filmmaker's part, but this kind of over-glamorizing of rich people and, you know, it's like not only is it kind of, I don't want to say it's alienating, especially speaking since I'm a crazy rich Asian and I don't relate with these crazy rich white people. Bad joke. I'm sorry. I was saving that for a whole week.
Move that to the front, too.
We'll just put all the offensive stuff at the beginning and see who stays around for the rest of the podcast.
Things were far simpler when you could write these things in emails and letters than voicing them in public.
I hate little people.
Oh, no, that's me.
Okay. But no, there is that kind of almost like pro-capitalist feel to the movie, which I don't think it's like some kind of evil conspiracy. Like, this is what the studio wanted, as opposed to the day where studios are so terrified to keep their business ventures looking respective that you can't even make a joke about a pizza company because somebody probably has a connection to a pizza company, but it does come off a little disturbing in hindsight or retrospect.
The happy ending for me is knowing that if this was real life, Fox Books would totally be absolved and destroyed by Amazon or something.
Yeah.
So Tom Hanks would be penniless and on the street.
I tried buying a book at Fox Books. They're closed.
F-O-X-F-U-C-K-U.
Yeah, but now the idea of like somebody who's like really wealthy because of family wealth and owning a big company who wants to become a better person, who, you know, introspectively looks into his own life and realizes he wants something better and hooks up with somebody in a smaller business. You know, that's a good idea for a story, you know, very much character redemption. But unlike how well it was handled with Mr. Monacek in the original movie, it just feels a little hollow and tacked on, especially since they set up so many different little plot points that go absolutely nowhere. It's a nice little journey with these somewhat likable characters in the first two acts, but then suddenly we rush everything in the third act, and it just comes off as a jumbled mess at the very end, into rather unsatisfying conclusions. Its heart is in the right place, and the actors are clearly doing their best playing likable characters, even if the situations are anything but likable. Yeah. But yeah, I think it's safe to say that a lot of modern rom-coms, especially in the world of television, they're just more shallow and weirdly mean-spirited too.
I think, for that matter, we were talking about Jimmy Stewart earlier. I think Tom Hanks, I think he has a much worse problem, though, at pulling off unlikable characters.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, you look at some of the unlikable characters Stewart has played, they're still interesting. Where Tom Hanks, I don't know, he still has that aw shucks way about him, to where the guy just seems unsympathetic and creepy.
You want to hear something funny? You want to hear something honestly funny?
I'm sure it'll knock me off my socks more than the movie. Go ahead.
Well, funny. I actually have You Got Mail playing in the background just in case there's something I missed with the subtitles. And while you're saying it, it's the sequence where Tom Hanks has flowers in hands and he's meeting Meg Ryan shortly after her business closed and she's sick. And you're right, you could do like a false one of those fan trailers where you can turn this movie into like a horror stalker film.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah,
I will say the thing I like the best about the film is the dynamic with Meg Ryan and her store being squeezed out by the big corporations. And I was telling Brayton this before we start recording that, you know, the reason why this film resonated with me more the first time I saw it was because when I first saw it, the video store that I worked in at the time, which was by a landslide my favorite of all my part-time jobs that I ever had, was also shut down for the exact same reason, being squeezed out by the bigger companies. And watching the final scenes where she, you know, the store gets cleaned out, everything's on sale, and then she, like, you know, takes one last look around the empty place, closes up, looks through the window one last time. That's exactly how my coworkers and I behaved after our store was shut down.
Yeah.
So they absolutely did nail that one part of the movie. You know, that's exactly what it was like for somebody like me who went through the exact same thing. And so, and yeah, even now watching the film again, you know, those feelings aren't quite as raw anymore. So the film doesn't hit me as hard now as it did back then. But, you know, I they did get that one part of the story right. I just wish they could have come up with a little better resolution than found a more challenging way to resolve the situation. You know, back in the days where you could have people who clearly do like each other but can't be together because of the stuff in the past that binds them. So it doesn't really work on its own terms before that point. Kind of clicks here and there with the Meg Ryan's character and her situation with her store being shut down. And then it just completely falls apart in those last two scenes, you know, where it's just like, you know, what were you guys even thinking? Do you yourselves even believe the dialogue you're writing?
Yeah. Like I said, it feels horrifically rushed at the very end. Like, you know, they wasted so much time setting everything up, and then it's like, oh, wait, we got to finish this movie.
And not just lazy and, you know, self-contradictory. Again, that line that irks me more than anything else. How can you forgive a guy for standing you up, but not me for this tiny little thing of ruining your business?
Like, yeah.
And like, things are not equivalents.
Yeah, and like I said, in hindsight, this movie does not age at all well. Like, it brings back nostalgic memories for that era where,
emails.
In hindsight, though, especially in a modern time where we now know the vast majority, if not almost every super rich person in charge of a company, are basically sociopaths as worse than Vodish. It's really hard to relate to this movie in any way. And it's funny too, like Brayton said this was going to be a fun Christmas style discussion. But
the first half was.
Yeah. But it's like I got traumatic post memory of being fired from jobs with the first movie, Shop Around the Corner, when Matacek gives that letter of recommendation. Mm-hmm. And then you have traumatic memories with the Shop Around the Corner and You Got Mail closing down. So thanks, Brayton. You ruined Christmas.
Wasn't You Got Mail set in Christmas time?
There is a section that takes place during Christmas.
Where the fuck was the snow?
Yeah, no, there were just...
Yeah, you're in New York!
Yeah. It hasn't snowed in New York since Satan was born. You can quote me on that, Conan O'Brien.
I'm going to say that my... you've got junk mail. That can be another... my one-liner snarky retort to this movie. But I'll again go to bat first. If you're going to see a Nora Ephron movie, see Sleepless in Seattle.
Yeah.
That's one that does stick the landing, is sweet, has some of the rom-com, you know, trimmings to it. So watch that. Don't watch Michael. Let that be my Christmas gift for you. Don't watch the movie Michael, she also directed.
Is that the one about the fat angel who eats pancakes?
John Travolta.
Like, yes. I said, the fat angel who eats pancakes. I did have a hypothetical idea for a sequel to Shop Around the Corner.
They're all dead. Who would you cast?
Okay, well, no, it's a direct sequel, same cast, but it's like, let's consider this. The movie takes place in Hungary, Budapest before the Second World War. And Vondish gets fired, right? So the sequel is basically a wartime movie where Mr. Matacek, in order to make extra money, has turned everybody into spies, but Vondish has gone over to the other side to have his revenge. Of course, Vondish is too stupid to realize that they're the bad guy, so to speak. So it would be like To Be or Not to Be, but not good. And Pepe, with his sword, will save everybody in the final battle when he kills you-know-who, Mr. Evil Mustache Meister.
That's a great selling point, Raf. You know, like To Be or Not to Be, but not good.
Yeah.
that immediately will sell tickets.
Yeah.
But not good.
Yeah. But not good is the suffix to any movie pitch, or it's the prefix. Yeah. The suffix. Yeah.
So I got this idea for a movie called You Got Mail. It's like Shop Around the Corner, but not good.
Yep.
In summary, you know, Shop Around the Corner, wonderful, love it, seen it multiple times, love it more every time I see it. You've Got Mail, not the worst thing ever, not the best thing ever, wouldn't really rush out to watch it again, but you know, if forced to endure it again, I could power through it until the last two scenes.
Yeah, it's always a treat to rewatch You've Got Mail. It's always a treat to rewatch Shop Around the Corner, which is like Shop Around the Corner, but good, because it is what it is. Yeah, I think there are just so many little moments in the movie that always stick with me. And the ending resolution of Shop Around the Corner, one of the sweetest, like, romantic scenes in the movie,
and
too.
And he messes with her without being a dick about it.
You're exactly right. He doesn't ruin her livelihood. Just a very simply directed scene between two phenomenal actors with great dialogue, and it feels earned, and it's a catharsis, and it's just a phenomenal ending to the movie.
Yeah.
It's a sweet little scene.
Yeah, it's a comedy, but it's truly romantic, as opposed to whatever a rom-com is supposed to be, so...
Yeah, it's a great feel-good, you know, ending. Doesn't make you feel cheapened or idiotic for feeling good at the end. You know, it doesn't feel like it's pandering to you at the end.
It's a lot more sophisticated and gently told way of directing feel-good films. Maybe it's because this doesn't get played ad nauseum in the Christmas rotation. That may be a reason why it hasn't lost its luster. But to be honest, I've watched it several times, and I really don't think it's capable of doing so. There's no such thing as a perfect movie, but this is, it's pretty perfect.
In addition to being a Christmas movie, I think this movie is just a excellent little wintertime movie. It's a movie that you can almost watch any time of the year, and it still holds up very well. And yeah, it's fantastic. I really hope there's a Blu-ray out there with like tons of really good extras on it.
From our friends at the Warner Archive, it is a good presentation of the movie.
Oh no! But,
no commentary or anything to speak of. There's the original trailer is included on it, and the trailer for the movie is really cute because it's Frank Morgan as Mr. Matacek, basically giving us a tour of his shop and the characters in it. And Ernst Lubitsch actually makes a little cameo at the end. So it's a cutely done trailer. not unlike Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho trailer, but you know, different subject matter.
Let me show you
matter.
Where the murder happened. This way.
Oh, the blood. It's so terrible.
Do you like Christmas goose? It's inside the shower.
But I want it all twisted and broken. Let's go upstairs now.
The bathroom.
And then as the camera's zooming and it zooms back, all of a sudden the cigarette boxes burst open and out comes Tom Hanks with a knife.
Suffice to say, there is a DVD present, a Blu-ray presentation of the film out there.
Okay, I adore the Warner Archives, and I really hope that it's a great service, and I really hope it survives the purging that's happening at Warner Brothers right now. Yeah. But in all honesty, it is kind of sad that there's not a Criterion version of this movie. But
yeah, that is peculiar. There have been several Lubitsch films released by, like, two of his famous ones, To Be or Not to Be and Anochka, and Heaven Can Wait has a Criterion release. Yeah. I know it was on the channel for a while, but a lot of the movies that get put on there, you know, just don't have a official release by them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they cycle out, like they purchase the rights for some films for a certain amount of time, and they go.
It's the drawback with any streaming service, really.
Exactly. Yeah. Yes.
Okay, so I'm pretty much done. So if you guys want to start ending this thing, I will be quiet.
Okay, what do you want us to say?
I love you, Raf.
So
here's a question: would you recommend this film to people who want to start getting into Lubitsch?
I would think this is a perfect place to start. I think three of his most heralded movies, this, Trouble in Paradise, and To Be or Not to Be, really show him at the height of his powers. He's a guy who never really lost it. And like another little postscript, I guess, which is a famously retorted story by Billy Wilder, him and the director William Wilder were actually the pallbearers at Lubitsch's funeral. And as they were walking away after the end of the service, Billy Wilder turns to Wyler and says, "What a shame, no more Lubitsch." And then William Wyler turns back to him and says, "Worse yet, no more Lubitsch pictures." I think this is as good a place as any to start. It's an unhateable movie, I think. Like I said, it's as close to perfection as you can get.
Yeah, I would go as far as to say this would be a great movie to recommend to anybody who has never seen a black and white movie, period, and is hesitant because of the old-timey nature. But no, this movie still holds up in many regards. Like I said, it's almost like the Clerks of his day. It has a lot of universal truth.
There you go again.
It has a lot of universal truth of like working in retail and dealing with both coworkers you like and don't like so much. Yeah. It's like you'd have to be a real nasty son of a gun not to enjoy this movie on any level. But it's like, I think this movie is just great. I'm glad we kind of thought outside the box and decided not to talk about more Japanese ghosts and talk about suicide attempts in a small store.
Well, we wanted something cheery to bring in the holiday season.
What's his name? Katana will harakiri himself, and there you go.
Just remake harakiri with Pepe.
Yeah, there you go.
I have come at the request of Mr. Marichuk to commit seppuku with a bamboo stick.
It's anyway. Gonna get bloody.
We got a lot of blood from this stone. This is a long one. But okay, to wrap things up, though, do you want us to make our Christmas pitches of what we're doing?
Sure.
Okay. Well, Raf and I do the movie Graveyard Shift again every Sunday on his Twitch channel. We're nearing the end of our first season. We'll end it at the new year with a screening of The Apartment, and they will in turn also be edited for this YouTube channel at a later date in truncated form. I don't know what we're doing at the time of this recording, but tune in every Sunday-ish, or we'll make announcements if plans change day-wise. But there's that. And Andres, Raf, and I are hoping to do a live stream on Andres's channel for Christmas of Jingle All the Way, which I swear to you, watch this movie instead of Jingle All the Way.
Jingle All the Way, it's like you got mail, but not good.
But even worse.
Yes. And Patrick, do you want to plug anything you got going on?
Yeah, sure. You can read my stuff at sci-fi.com, tohokingdom.com, ourculturemag.com, offscreen.com. At the time of this recording, I recently published a sizable essay on Yasujiro Ozu. And I also, I don't really do a whole lot of YouTubing anymore, but I recently uploaded a short documentary about Hudia, who in the 1920s and 30s was China's most popular film star. I'm quite happy with how that documentary turned out. You can find it on my YouTube channel, which is just my name, Patrick Galvan. And I also have a book out right now on one of Hu Jia's contemporaries, Ruan Ling Yu, who was also a very popular Chinese film actress in the 20s and the 30s, covering her life, her career, and the history of her industry and the history of China in the early 20th century. It's titled Ruan Ling Yu, Her Life and Career. And you can find it on Amazon.com in both Kindle and paperback.
And not at Fox Books.
And not available at Fox Books.
Nope.
So we saved Christmas, guys. Back into the space heaven.
I don't want to be blob number two again.
Hey, guys, got a news flash for you. We're not supernatural. We're just three guys hunkered behind their computers talking to microphones.
I'm mortal?
Yeah.
Oh, bah humbug.
Might as well just get killed by the giant bird right now.
Oh, my God!
Leonard, no!